the Gentiles lord it over those they have authority over. One of the things that I noticed when we lived in China, by the way, I love Chinese people, so anytime I say something that's critical of Chinese people, my heart always breaks. But I'm going to tell you anyway. One of the things that I noticed about China, frankly, since I've come back to Canada, I notice it in Canada now too, but the idea is that you become a leader so that you can exploit other people. That's why you become a leader. It's not about responsibility or service or taking care of others. It's so I can get stuff. For example, very quickly, at my university, all of the graduate students had part-time jobs. They didn't get paid for their part-time jobs, but they had part-time jobs. They would babysit their professor's children. They would paint their professor's home. Why? Because that was their professor, and you had to do whatever he or she told you to do because they were in charge of you. So the Gentiles do lord it over those that are under their authority. But what did Jesus say about himself? I have come not to be served, but to serve, and to give my life a ransom for many. And the one who wants to be the leader must be the servant of all. Today we want to conclude our series on the book of 1 Peter. 1 Peter, a living hope in a world of suffering. Peter has been talking for several chapters already. In the first two chapters, he talked about the benefits of being a believer, the eternal inheritance that's uncorruptible or incorruptible, undefiled, and unfading. He's talked about who we are in Christ, the royal priesthood. He's talked about how to live in our relationships with husbands and wives and with masters and with servants and so on. And then beginning in the middle of chapter 3, he has an extended passage on suffering. From chapter 3, verse 13 to 22, he's talked about the value of Christian suffering. Suffering is a blessing to us, not because we enjoy suffering, but because it refines us. It's also an opportunity because by recognizing that this suffering is for our good and enduring under it, it becomes a means of sharing our faith with others. And it also has value because it follows the example of Jesus. Then when we moved into chapter 4, Peter talked about how to prepare for Christian suffering. He talked about the right thinking we need to have about the past, being done with the past and all those things that used to trip us up, and living a holy life in the present, thinking about the future where we will receive that eternal glory. And 2 weeks ago, we looked at the last part of chapter 4 about how to respond to Christian suffering by rejoicing that we are worthy to suffer for Jesus, to glorify God in that suffering, just as Jesus did, and continue to be faithful because God is faithful to us. So as we wind up the book of 1 Peter and our last sermon on the book of 1 Peter, the title for the message today is The Last Word on Christian Suffering. Peter has been talking about this for over two chapters, and now he's coming to the end of his book, and he wants to reemphasize all that he has said and sum it all up in not necessarily simple terms, but very direct terms. And we're going to see today that throughout these verses, there are exhortations. Don't do this, do this. Don't do this, do this. Don't do this, do this. So today, we want to look at the last word on Christian suffering. But as we do that, let's bow one more time for a word of prayer. Father God, we thank you that Jesus came, that he was willing to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. And because he was willing to serve, there is salvation full and free available to us now because of all that he has done for us. And because he has done this, you have honored him and glorified him by putting him at your right hand to sit on his throne forever. So we thank you for Jesus. We thank you for all that he has done for us. And now as we look at 1 Peter chapter 5, I pray that you would guide our thoughts, that your Holy Spirit would be moving in our hearts as we hear your word and what you are calling us to do, that we would be faithful and obedient in to hear his promptings and to act on them. So bless our time as we listen to your voice and cleanse my lips now to speak your truth. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. The last word on Christian suffering. Peter's going to deal with this church on suffering by taking a look back now inside the church. If all of this outside is all messed up and people hate you and people are against you, what about back inside the church? And Peter, in this section of chapter 5, has two exhortations that he wants to give to us. And those two exhortations are simply this. Number one, follow the shepherd. And we're going to see that in verses 1 to 5. Follow the shepherd. And then in verses 6 to 11, he's going to tell us to fight the lion. Follow the shepherd and fight the lion. So let's see what he has to say. As I said, verses 1 to 5, he talks about following the shepherd. So when we begin verse 1 starts with a very simple word. It starts with the word so. In other words, a lot of people have looked at chapter 5 and they've said, Peter spent all this time talking about suffering and now he just seems to branch off onto something completely different. But that very first word, so, is the Greek word oun, and basically what it means is, because of everything I have already said, I want to say this to you now. In other words, there is a direct connection between what he has been saying and what he wants to say now. So, because all of this is true about Christian suffering, now I want to talk to you about suffering in the church. And here's what he has to say. First of all, I exhort the elders among you as a fellow elder and a witness of the sufferings of Christ, as well as a partaker in the glory that is going to be revealed. Peter starts by identifying himself with the people that he's talking to. And he wants to speak specifically, first of all, to the elders. Now, I'm going to speak to the elders, and you're probably thinking, okay, this is a good part for me to fall asleep, because there's only four elders in this church, and so Bob and Michael and David, and now I'm drawing a blank. Who's the other one? Lloyd, his lordship, yes, sorry. They have to listen to this part, and I can just go to sleep. But hold on, because what he says to the elders is directly linked to what he says to you in verse 5. So hang on, okay? But he starts by talking to the elders. Why does he start with them? Because all through the book he's been talking about suffering. Suffering as a Christian, suffering for the sake of Jesus, suffering because you are doing what God has called you to do. And so he begins with the elders because the elders are the ones who are on the front line. Elders are the ones who are leading the church. Elders are the ones who are responsible to take care of the church. And so when suffering comes, it typically comes, as I like to call the elders, the face of the franchise. The ones who are leading are the ones who are going to experience flack from the society first, because they're the ones who are leading. And so when Peter speaks to them, he doesn't speak to them and call himself an apostle, as he had at the beginning of the book. He calls himself a fellow elder. He knows what they're going through. He knows what the struggles are. He knows how hard this role is. So he's not speaking to them as someone over them, but as one who is with them. And he says, I am a fellow elder. I am a witness of the sufferings of Christ. I have seen up close what it means to suffer. I watched Jesus suffer, not just on the cross, but in his dealings with the Pharisees, in the frustration he must have felt when people didn't understand what he was trying to say to them. I am a witness of the sufferings of Christ, but I am also a partaker in the glory that is going to be revealed. Peter is like a broken record. Suffering always leads to glory. Suffering always leads to glory. Suffering always leads to glory. So I know, elders, that you're suffering. I know, because I'm an elder too. I saw our leader, Jesus, the Son of God, suffer. But I know that he has received glory, and I too, and you too, will receive glory. So this is how he begins to speak to the church. And starting in verse 2, he begins to tell them what it is that they are to do. So in verse 2, he says this: Shepherd the flock of God that is among you. Exercise oversight. Now, this idea of shepherding, being a shepherd to guide and to lead and to nurture and guard the flock, is not something that Peter himself has invented. Throughout the Old Testament, Israel is looked upon as sheep. Jeremiah 24, Ezekiel 34, both of those passages talk about how Israel is like a sheepfold. And in Jeremiah 24, there's a prophecy that a shepherd is going to come who will be righteous and good and take care of the sheep. Ezekiel 34, on the other hand, talks about how the shepherds of the people are treating them badly, talking about the religious leaders of the time and how they were exploiting them and cheating them and not leading and guarding and nurturing them. But when Jesus comes, what does he call himself? I am the good shepherd. Ezekiel 34 talks about the bad shepherds, but Jesus in John 10 is the good shepherd, and the good shepherd gives his life for the sheep. And by extension, when Peter messes up and he denies Jesus three times, when Jesus restores him in John 21, Jesus says to him three times, after he has denied Jesus three times, Jesus speaks to Peter three times and says to him what? Feed my sheep. Feed my sheep. Take care of my flock. So Peter knows what he's talking about when he says here that the job of the elders is to shepherd the flock of God. But notice how he describes them. Shepherd the flock of God that is among you. In other words, when you look today in the world, this is one of the big distinctions between the Eastern world and the Western world. In the Western world, shepherds usually stand behind the sheep and push them forward. But in the Eastern world, shepherds stand in front of the sheep and lead them on. And Jesus and Peter are from the Eastern world. They know that the shepherd's duty is to be out in front and to lead the sheep and to guide them and to exercise oversight and protect them and make sure that everything is okay. But what does Peter say here? He doesn't say, shepherd the flock of God that is behind you. What does he say? Shepherd the flock of God that is among you. In other words, you are part of this sheepfold. You are not simply the one who is out in front leading. You are leading from among this group. You are part of this group. And that's going to become important later when he talks about Jesus' role. But what does he say to them? Whatever your position is as a shepherd of the flock of God that is among you, you are to exercise oversight. You are to take care of the sheep. When the danger of suffering and persecution from the outside comes around, you are the ones who are to be guarding and taking care of the sheep and making sure that everything is okay for them. Now, beginning in the second part of verse 2 and continuing on to verse 3, he's going to give three ways that the shepherds, the elders, are to exercise this oversight. And in typical Peter fashion, he doesn't simply say, do this, do this, do this. He says, don't do this, do this. Don't do this, do this. And don't do this, do this. So what is the first one, he says? In the second part of verse 2, he says this. If you're going to exercise authority or oversight in the church, it first of all needs to be motivated by God's call. He says this oversight is not under compulsion, but willingly as God would have you. Being an elder is not an easy job. In fact, it's a hard job. And sometimes in churches, hopefully not in this church, but sometimes in churches, when elders are selected, there's a little bit of arm twisting that goes on. Come on, we really need you. And there's almost a shaming that goes on to say, you have to take this job. Nobody else will do it. We need you to do it. And yet, what does Peter say? If you're going to exercise oversight, it can't be under compulsion. You can't have your arm twisted. You can't take this job out of guilt. You need to take this job because you sense that God has called you to this role. And this is something that you are doing in obedience to what he has called you to do. I think all of our elders in this church, I can tell you as a witness, they are motivated by God's call. They are not motivated by compulsion. And I pray that that will always be the case in this church. Secondly, he says in the last part of verse 2, that they should be motivated by love. He says, they need to exercise oversight, but not for shameful gain, but eagerly. I think we all know of pastors and church leaders around the world who drive big fancy cars, have the big jets, wear the nicest suits. You may not have noticed, I wear the exact same suit every week. I wear the same tie, wear the same shirt every week. I'm not saying, give me more clothes. I'm saying, I'm not here for shameful gain. The elders in our church are not here for shameful gain. They volunteer. They're working for free. So if they were motivated by money, they're the dumbest elders on the planet. Because they're not motivated by money. Because they don't get any money. But at the same time, there can be other kinds of shameful gain. Whereas people begin to think, I will be respected. People will look up to me. And it becomes a source of pride. And this can be a different kind of shameful gain. But Peter says, no, when you're exercising oversight, you can't be greedy. You can't be proud. You need to be motivated by love. You need to say, I want to take this job so I can help people because I love them and I want to serve them. That's the third qualification or third motivation that he talks about in verse 3 when he says this. Not domineering over those in your charge, but being examples to the flock. Not domineering those over those in your charge. Remember James and John in our scripture reading today? They wanted to sit on Jesus' right and left. And the disciples got ticked off because they heard that these guys wanted to be the top, the boss. And Jesus completely flips this around and he says, if you want to be a leader, if you want to be a leader in the church, you become a servant of all. Because the real leader of the church, who is Jesus, didn't come to be served. He came to serve and give his life as a ransom for many. So if I'm going to be an elder, if any of us are going to be elders, it can't be so that we can boss people around. Archie, go get me a drink of water. You, go fix this, whatever these annoying fans are doing now. Go fix that. Do whatever. No. The one who leads the church of God needs to do so humbly, in service, by being examples to the flock. I watched a video this week, Sinclair Ferguson was a guy I used to teach at my seminary many years ago, but he had a video series, and in that video series he talks about this verse, and it spoke volumes to me because it made me ask the question, can I say yes? Because his question was, when people come into your church who've never been to this church before, and they look around and they say, what is Christianity all about? Can you point to the elders in your church and say, look at them? That's what Christianity is all about. I wish I could say yes. For me, I'm not talking about the other elders, but for me. But that spoke volumes to me to say, as a leader in this church, am I being an example for the flock? This is what it means to be a leader, to exercise oversight, called by God, motivated by love, and motivated by service to those that you're leading. He finishes his exhortation to the elders by saying this in verse 4. When the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the unfading crown of glory. Why are the elders leading from among the people? Because the real shepherd, the chief shepherd, is Jesus. He is the one leading this church. One of my favorite books in my library, the title of the book is Jesus is the Pastor of This Church. I am not the pastor of this church. Jesus is the pastor of this church. He is the chief shepherd. He is the one leading this church. And so what the elders are doing by being members of this church, they are leading the flock that is among them because they themselves are following the chief shepherd. And when that chief shepherd appears, when Jesus Christ returns, that is the time when you and I will receive the unfading crown of glory. Some people say, that sounds like a very selfish motivation. I work hard, I'm a servant to people, I love people, I do all of these things, but I do it so that I get the paycheck when I get to heaven. I'll get all this good stuff when I go to heaven. But I think what Peter is talking about is kind of what Paul talks about in Philippians 4. Because in Philippians 4, Paul talks about a crown of glory as well. And you know what his crown of glory is in Philippians chapter 4? The Philippian believers. The Philippian believers themselves are Paul's crown of glory. That when he gets to glory and he looks around and he sees the lady who sold purple cloth and he sees the guy that was the prison guard in heaven, and he will be with them forever and ever and ever and ever. That is his crown of glory. When Cindy and I went to China, we had big dreams that hundreds or thousands of people would come to faith in Jesus Christ because we were there. The first year we were there, you know how many people came to faith? Zero. We thought we were doing something wrong. Maybe we were, I don't know. But in the second year we were there, we met a young girl named Benita. And Benita, I only taught Benita because the first teacher that was assigned to her to teach all of her English classes was an alcoholic and got fired in the third week of school. And from the fourth week of school, and for the next 3 years, Benita was in all of my classes, even in the classes that she wasn't registered for. She just followed me around the school. And she would come to my office during office hours, and I would talk to her about Jesus. She would call me on the phone on the weekend, and we would talk together about Jesus. And on Easter Sunday of her third year, Benita gave her life to Jesus. And we had other students give their lives to Jesus as well. But I said to Benita one day, I said, if I'm in China for 50 years, and you're the only person who had come to faith, it would be worth it. Because when I'm in glory with Jesus and I look over here and I see Benita, she is my crown of glory. It's worth it. It matters because this is not about the here and now only. It is about eternity. Do your job and do it well, because when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the unfading crown of glory. It will never go away. So that's what he has to say to the elders. Now you can wake up if you're not an elder, because this is the part for you. Verse 5 says this, likewise, you who are younger. Now, maybe you're thinking, I'm older than the elders. Well, good. I'm glad you lived a very long and healthy life. But he's simply saying, for the rest of the people in the church, likewise, you who are younger, be subject to the elders. In other words, the goal of the elders is to be followable. And the task of the people in the church is to follow the followable. You who are younger, be subject to the elders. Listen to them. Recognize what it is that they are trying to do for you. Follow them. Be subject to them. So he has four verses to speak to the elders and half a verse to speak to everyone else. But then he speaks to everyone in the last part of verse 5 when he says this. Clothe yourselves, all of you, elders, younger, everybody, clothe yourselves, all of you, with humility toward one another, for God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. James quotes this verse as well in James 4, verse 6, but it comes actually from the Old Testament in Proverbs chapter 3, verse 34. So what is Peter saying? The uniform of the church is humility. Clothe yourselves, all of you, with humility. If you're an elder, you're not supposed to be thinking, hey, I'm better than you, do what I say. And if you're not an elder, you're a member of the church, you're not supposed to be looking at other people and saying, I'm better than them. I'm better than that one. I'm better than this one. Or, stupid elders, why are they making us do this stupid stuff? I don't like them. And clothe yourselves, all of you, with humility, because God opposes the proud but gives grace to the humble. Who is the most humble? Jesus. Jesus showed his humility when he washed the disciples' feet. And when he washed the disciples' feet, two of the people's feet that he washed, one was going to betray him and one was going to deny him three times. And yet Jesus washed their feet as well. So now Peter is saying to us, put on this uniform, clothe yourselves with humility, because that's what God wants you to do, and God gives grace to those who are humble. So follow the shepherd who's leading the elders among you to live a life of humility that will lead to glory. The last part of the chapter talks about fighting the lion. And Peter's going to give three exhortations about how we can fight Satan. And when suffering comes and when difficulties comes, what is it that we're supposed to do? And here's what he says, beginning in verse 6. Number one, he says, put God first. In verse 6, he says, humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that at the proper time he may exalt you. This phrase, the mighty hand of God, was used all through the first five books of the Old Testament, the Pentateuch, the law. Whenever God led people out of Egypt, or he provided manna for them, or any sort of miracle that God did for them, it was provided under the mighty hand of God. And Peter is reminding them that God is powerful, and so they need to humble themselves under God, because when pressure comes and difficulty comes and we try to solve all of our problems ourselves, we are actually saying, I am big enough and strong enough to solve this on my own. But when we humble ourselves and we say, God, I need you, I need your mighty hand, and I need you to take care of this for me, God will take care of you, and at the proper time, he will exalt you. So how do we put God first? He tells us in verse 7, we need to cast all your anxieties on him. because he cares for you. When the pressure of suffering as a Christian becomes great and difficult and terrible, and we are worried, how is this going to work out? How am I going to fix it? I can't fix it. Jesus can fix it. So I need to cast all my anxieties on him because he cares for me. So how do I fight the lion? The first thing I do is I put God first. Secondly, in verse 8, I need to be careful and alert. Peter says this, be sober-minded. Earlier in the book, he's talked about being alert. It's the same word. It's the idea of don't be intoxicated. Don't have a foggy brain. Be sober-minded. Be watchful. Your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion seeking someone to devour. Peter has said earlier in the book, don't be surprised when you fall into different trials, as if something strange were happening. And he's re-emphasizing this here to say, Satan's goal is to wreck your life as a believer in Jesus. And he is like a roaring lion. Do you know when lions roar? When they're hungry. And he's looking to destroy you, to devour you. Peter himself knows this very well because Jesus said to Peter in Luke 22, Satan has desired to sift you like wheat. But you know how that verse ends? But I have prayed for you that you will come out okay. So Satan has a job to do. And what is his job? His job is to cause problems for the Christian. And so we need to be careful and alert, knowing that he is out there, knowing what he is trying to do. And what is he trying to do? When you look in the New Testament, Satan is evil. And he tries to do the same kinds of things over and over and over again to mess up God's people and to mess up his church. Typically, he tries three things. You see this in the book of Acts. In Acts chapter 4, Acts chapter 5, and Acts chapter 6. What happens in Acts chapter 4? The religious leaders see the Peter and James and John, and they're going around preaching. So what do? They beat them, put them in prison. They try to intimidate them. And yet, they refuse to stop. What happens in chapter 5? Ananias and Sapphira come, and they bring money. And they think, ooh, I'm going to fool everybody and get some prestige in this church by giving part of the money and making it look like I'm giving all of the money. Satan likes to use false ambition and pride. And then in chapter 6, what happens? There's a big fight about who gets fed first. This group or that group? In other words, Satan loves to use secondary issues in the church. How many of you know of churches where churches have split over they couldn't agree on the color of the drapes? I know a church where they split over the color of the drapes. I know of a church where they split over the fact that some people wanted to spend money on new carpet for the auditorium. Some people wanted to spend money on missionaries. And they split the church. Satan has these tactics of intimidation and false ambition and getting us sidetracked on secondary issues. But what is our job? Our job is to be sober-minded and alert and recognize when Satan is doing his nonsense, to say to him, get lost. I am putting myself under the mighty hand of God who will take care of me and this church. Lastly, he says in verse 9, resist him. That is the devil. Resist him firm in the faith, knowing that the same kinds of suffering are being experienced by your brotherhood throughout the world. Don't give up. Keep on believing because you are not alone. Resist him. Stay firm. All these other ones have gone through it. And you can look through the pages of history and see believers century after century after century who have said, as Martin Luther said, I cannot and I will not recant. Even if you kill me, I will not. And there are others. And so when we look around, both in history and today, and see fellow believers who are struggling, and they are saying to us, and we are saying to them, don't give up. Don't quit. Fight the lion, because it's worth it. And that's how he ends in verse 10 and verse 11. Why should we keep going? Why should we be careful and alert? Why should we put God first? He says in verse 10, after you have suffered a little while, the God of all grace, who has called you to his eternal glory in Christ, will himself restore, confirm, strengthen, and establish you. Peter knows exactly what he's talking about here. Peter denied Jesus three times. And after Jesus rose from the dead, what did he do with Peter? He restored him. And then in John 21, when he said, feed my sheep, he confirmed him. And then in Acts 2, he sent his Holy Spirit to strengthen him. And now he has established him as an apostle of this church. God is gracious and kind, and he has called us into eternal glory. And if we are willing to put ourselves under his mighty hand, he will restore, confirm, strengthen, and establish us. Why? Because he's on his throne. And that's the last words that Peter has to say. To him be the dominion forever and ever. Amen. Because God is the boss and he is in charge. Satan is not in charge. Satan is a roaring lion, but God is on his throne and he will have dominion forever and ever. So what are you going to do? What are you going to do? We've talked about following and fighting. Following the shepherd starts with humility. All through this passage, he's been talking about humility. It starts with humility for the elders. It continues with humility for the younger ones. And just in case he didn't cover everybody, he says at the end that everyone should clothe themselves with humility. If this church is going to stand against persecution, if it's going to be the salt and light that it needs to be, we need to be humble together and follow the chief shepherd. Because when we do, it ends with gracious glory provided by God. We also need to fight the lion. And again, this starts with humility. We have to put God first and say, I can't solve this on my own. God, I need you. We need to be humble enough to say, I know that Satan is out there And we need to be watching. And I need to be humble enough to say, I trust God, and my faith will stay strong because I know that God's gracious glory is waiting for me. So whether we're following the shepherd or fighting the lion, it all starts with humility. But if we're willing to humble ourselves and do what God says, it's going to end with gracious glory that never ends. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you so much for the book of 1 Peter. Thank you for its encouragement to us that we, when we suffer, when we are struggling, because we have put our faith and trust in you, when Satan, as a roaring lion, is clawing at us and biting at us, that we can humble ourselves under the mighty hand of God, whose dominion is forever and ever. Help us to live that humble life in your church, to be the people that you have called us to be, to follow you the way that you have called us to follow, to fight the lion the way you have called us to fight. And may our testimony be that example that shines a light on the world so that they will see that you are the Lord, and they will turn and give their lives to you and join us and receive that crown of glory that is unfading and forever. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.